Hi, welcome to the first episode of Decanted with Dave Grega. And I'm really excited to bring the first guest. I can't think of a better first guest. This is Major Chris Morisoli. And Major Morisoli is from right here in the Napa Valley, based out of the Napa Valley. He has a long family history with an amazing vineyard, Morisoli Vineyard. And we're going to talk a lot about family history and how that came to be. Born here in St. Helena, and grew up in Rutherford, right in the heart of the valley. So a really cool story there. And also is in the United States Army. He's an officer in the Army and has deployed to Iraq and Afghanistan. It's a really incredible story with regards to that. And for me, being someone in the wine business and someone who has served in the United States Army, this just makes so much sense to me. So Chris, thanks so much for joining me today. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks, Dave. Absolutely. I'm pretty honored to be number one. You know, sorry you couldn't get any better talent, but hey, I'm here ready to rock and roll, buddy.
Awesome. Great. So I want to start talking about, and the whole point of this podcast is to introduce people to the amazing stories that that I see in so many individuals that I've met in my time in the wine business, not just on the business side, but also on the consumer side, customers and things like that. I've met really interesting people that have amazing stories. And your story is one that I want to share with people. So I'd love to just get started and kind of talk a little bit about Morisoli Vineyard and how your family became involved in the Napa Valley. Where did that start? What's the origin story of the family vineyard?
Sure, absolutely. Well, you know, it's a really, I guess I would say, a traditional kind of Italian immigrant story, Swiss Italian to be exact. And it starts back in about 1883 when my great-great-grandpa, Rocco Morisoli, came over from Italy, well, actually Switzerland at the time, and that would have been the Ticino, Monte Carasso region of Switzerland, came over, and he was worked in dairies and was a goat herder in Switzerland, and, you know, not a whole lot of, like, future in that business at the time. So a lot of Swiss Italians were migrating over here to California, especially into Napa County. And he came over, and in 1893, 10 years after he arrived, he got married to my great-great-grandmother, Lodovina. And they kind of worked some odd jobs. He was, you know, working in dairies and farming and a little bit of grapes here and there. And they finally settled in 1902 on Nibom Lane, which is kind of the site that we're still at today. So
Nibom Lane, that's a pretty famous piece of land there. So for those who don't know where that is or where Rutherford is, not everyone's a wine that you're familiar with the Napa Valley, but people know the Napa Valley is a world-class grape growing region, but specifically that area where your family settled is a really famous area. You want to talk just a little bit about what that area is and what it means and what it is today?
Yeah, absolutely. So Rutherford's my home. It'll always be my home. It's a fantastic spot, especially what they call the Rutherford Bench, which is right off of Nibom Lane. Just kind of the, if you imagine all the alluvial soils that have come off of the Mayacamas Range and kind of has this little elevated section, really kind of between South St. Helena and north of Yountville. But that's the bench, and beautiful spot, great for growing grapes. And I guess that's why Rocco and Lodovina decided to live there. You know, to do something they'd known what to do, which was to farm. So moved there in 1902. They kind of sharecropped the area at first. And then he mysteriously left, she remarried, and then she ended up buying the ranch in her name. And that was in 1910. And then they had a son, Plinio, and three other kids who kind of grew up there. And she remarried. And they continue to grow grapes. And anyway, there's a lot more we can get into. But yeah, just a great spot. And back then, it wasn't any type of, you know, amazing cult wines or celebrity farming. It was just like a way of life. And they sold grapes to mostly to places like Christian Brothers. And it was a lot of it was going towards Sacramento wine. And that kind of kept them alive through Prohibition.
Right, through Prohibition. That's right. Christian Brothers has been doing a lot of wine production. So it's interesting. That's one of the cool things about the story is that it's an authentic story. It's not like, rich person made a fortune and came over and bought a bunch of expensive land in Napa Valley. Not that that's bad. It's just, this is a story of someone who came here, started sharecropping, and through all of these things ended up, you know, buying some land in what ended up being an amazing grape growing region, which was a good grape growing region back then, but it's now a famous, world famous grape growing region. So your grandmother, the original plot that she kind of purchased, is that still the same plot now, or has it expanded or contracted over the generations?
Yep. It is still there. The original 10 acres is what she actually bought in 1910, which is where the site of our old family house is still on. So same 10 acres there. And then each generation has, you know, added to. Her son Plinio ended up buying another 10 acres of the Doak Ranch, which was adjacent. The Doak Ranch kind of bordered Tokalon and went up again kind of towards the north by where Inglenook is. So he bought that extra 10 acres. And the really cool story that I like about my great-grandpa Plinio is he used to own the general store, which was right where the Rutherford Grill is today. Okay. So he bought the Rutherford store. He owned and worked that for a few years. And one of his jobs was to take supplies up to the miners on the top of Mount St. John, because they had a bunch of old Quicksilver mines up there. Yeah. He was the shop owner there, you know, kind of in his spare time. He would tend to the vineyard, work the vineyard. And then he would actually sell grapes for $20 a ton. That was the going rate in like the 1930s. So it's changed a bit, right?
What's the average, like, high quality Rutherford per ton price?
Oh, let's see. Napa Valley average for a cab this year, I think was it $7,900 a ton?
At least, yeah.
And that's just the average. So goes up from there.
Right. Yeah. But considerably. Okay.
So anyway, I'm sure he would have had a stroke if he'd have heard that we're selling grapes for $8,000 a ton, and he was getting $20 a ton.
Oh my God. Yeah, I know. That's wild. So that was your great grandfather.
Correct. Yeah. Plinio.
Wow. Okay. Plinio. These names are amazing too.
They're cool. Yeah. The names Plinio rapidly divulged into very American as we look. Yeah. We went from Crasco, Plinio to Phil, Gary, and Chris. So.
Yeah. That's amazing. Okay. So that's really interesting. So we have that family history, and then that was your great grandfather. Mm-hmm. And so from your grandfather to your dad, what was the big evolution in the Morosoli vineyard?
Sure. So, let's see, after, Plinio, my grandpa helped run the vineyard. He actually owned, was a part owner of Harold Smith, the, you know, construction and concrete folks in St. Helena. And while doing that, he bought an extra additional 17 acres. And then my dad inherited some of that vineyard, also bought the 17 acres from my grandpa. And then he added another 20 acres in the 90s of the adjacent land, which was the Zeger Ranch. And he purchased that in 91, rounding everything out to about 57 total acres, and 53 of that is planted. So
53.
And that's what we have today. So
that is that's a pretty big chunk of real estate, especially in that area. It's incredible.
I'd love to say I would like to add on to it at some point, but I don't know if it would ever be possible at this point to add.
Yeah. I mean, that's kind of what we're talking about. That's why this story is so cool. It was like, you know, to come over here and purchase 53 acres in that area, I can't even imagine what that would cost.
Yeah. It'd be impossible.
Okay. So before we start with your origin story real quick, since we've been talking about the family vineyard and a little bit about Rutherford, we hear a lot in the wine industry about Rutherford dust and the idea of what makes Rutherford great grape growing region. You kind of mentioned before that benchland and everything. Is there anything else that you want to talk about as far as, like, maybe not just what makes it a great region, but like what are some of the shining characteristics of that benchland Rutherford, you know, grapes turned into wine? How does that manifest in the bottle as something that's unique and incredible?
Sure. Well, you know, Andre Chelichev, one of the folks that have probably done the most for Rutherford or really Napa wine in general, who is the winemaker at Beaulieu Vineyards for such a long time, he famously said it takes Rutherford dust to grow a great Cabernet. And that's kind of where I think that term came from. But man, Rutherford dust, to me, it's more of a feeling and more of a smell and more of a kind of something you take from it. It's not really, it's hard to point specific taste, right?
Sure.
But to me, it's a feeling and a smell, and it's that kind of that minerally kind of down to earth, dusty feeling that I get from wines that come from there. That's really, you know, some people say, oh, it's kind of like a bit of like powdered chocolate, or, you know, there's a bunch of different words and you can describe it however you want. And I think it's kind of up to everyone's interpretation. But for me, really, it's the smell. It's that kind of getting your hands in the dirt and the, that pervasive dust, which is everywhere. And when you're driving the tractor, you definitely know that it gets everywhere.
It's in your lungs. It's everywhere.
It is. Yeah. But it's such a fine, powdery dust. And it just, and that's one thing my dad always would say was, oh, it's just the dirt. You know, why are the grapes so good here? And he says, it's the dirt, and it is that really fantastic, kind of decomposed mountain that just comes down off of Mount St. John. And really, if you were growing corn or tomatoes or some actual other crop, it would be probably not really great land for it, because it's not, you know, it's not particularly, what's the word I'm looking for? Soil that's like really vibrant. It's not the best soil for growing crops, but it works really well for grapes because the vines struggle a little bit. They have to shoot roots really far down. Especially in that well-drained soil, there's not a lot of water that they can get to readily. So they've got to work hard. And by working hard, the grapes end up being really concentrated and very, very excellent in quality.
Yeah, I agree. The wines that I've tasted from Rutherford have been amazing. I've always had a lot of respect for that region. I've been fortunate enough to make some wines from some great vineyard sites in Rutherford, and I hope to be able to continue to do that too. So it's kind of cool. And that's how I heard about your family vineyard, to be honest with you.
Cool.
Before I even knew about you. But so where do you come in? What's your origin story? You're born in St. Helena, but grew up in Rutherford, in the Rutherford dust, and kind of, what was that experience like? I mean, not many people can say that they grew up, you know, on a family vineyard in Napa.
Sure. Yeah, it was great. I mean, born in 84, and then spent my whole life on Nibon Lane. And most of that was, you know, either running around getting dirty or hiking on Mount St. John or cruising around on four-wheelers, always helping my dad, you know, farming. I was driving four-wheelers at like 4 years old and tractors at about six or seven. And, you know, my first job was to water the rows down. My dad's very particular about keeping the rows, you know, the avenues wet and not dusty. Antithesis of the Rutherford dust, you know, just to keep mites down and keep it from getting too dusty. So that was my job. And it was drive the water truck or the water tractor and keep those rows watered down. And then, you know, my dad would put me on there and have me sulfur or spray or, you know, any variety of tasks you could find, on the vineyard. So, but then on my off time, I would always, like I said, hiking around, we would fly model airplanes. We would go hiking and shooting and four wheeling and, just a free range, childhood, which is in retrospect, I thought that was normal for everybody, you know, who doesn't get to just go run around and go climb in the mountains. But, in retrospect, super fortunate that opportunity when a lot of people, you know, don't. So,
yeah, no. And I think, you know, I mean, that's what you want, that free range, the ability to go out there, get drink, to be, you know, watching your dad and being invited to level up and be, you know, take on more responsibility. Now you can drive the tractor. Now you can help me with this. And I think that's amazing. It's missing these days. So you really did luck out in that arena. Now you've been involved with a lot of service-oriented, you know, adventures in your life. And where did that sort of, was there any thing or any aha moment or just something like you always knew you wanted to help people or be of service or felt called to service, or was it just random? What's the story behind that?
You know, I think a lot of it kind of stems back to the Rutherford Volunteer Fire Department, RFD, and my uncle Mike, who also farms kind of closer to 29, more solely Borges Vineyard. He was always on the fire department, and that's kind of one thing I grew up with, always running down the firehouse and helping out. I think my senior project, I did a video for the St. Helena Fire Department like a recruiting video, and I was hooked. I loved it. I had a pager. I get to go to all the fires. Cool. I was so into it. So then when I turned 18, I joined the Rutherford Fire Department, which I absolutely loved. Just a total cast of characters in that place.
That's got the famous bell. For those of you who don't know, or the famous siren.
Right? Yep.
I mean, there's the volunteer fire department there has this loud siren. It sounds almost like a what is it called? Like a bomb?
An air raid siren. Yeah,
Sonoma County.
That goes off.
Right. And so can you talk a little bit about that siren? Like,
oh, yeah, man. That? It's great. So the siren's the best. Everyone freaks out, especially tourists eating at the Rutherford Grill. Siren goes off in the middle of the day. Everyone thinks that we're, Sonoma County is coming over to bomb us.
Right.
It goes off 4 times. It's really loud. I do feel bad for the neighbors that live right next to it, but it's also part of the community, you know? So, yeah. And anytime you hear it, you know that there's some sort of an emergency going on, and there'll be.
So it goes off when there's a call or an emergency.
Yes, anytime there's a call. Yep. So
okay.
Our pagers will go off. This is this guy right here. It'll beep, and then the next tone is for the siren, and it'll go off. St. Helena has the same one, but they've got it limited to only I think fires and traffic accidents now. So Rutherford still goes off for anything.
Okay. But gotcha.
Anyway, it was exciting. You hear it, yeah. You get to see what's going on. Right.
I've been one of those people when I first moved to the Valley eating at Rutherford Grill.
Yeah.
And it goes off in them. And, you know, with my military background too, I had no clue about this fire. I didn't know it was a fire department. I didn't know anything. So I hear this thing and I'm like, oh my God, you know,
where's the IDF? Where's the indirect fire?
Yeah. Yeah. They found me.
Gotcha.
I'm trying to finish my cornbread before I get blown up. So that's really cool. So that having the Rutherford Fire Department there, and it's the volunteer fire department, I think is that correct?
Yep. Yeah, it's all that.
Okay. Yeah. Right. Which is really cool. But having that there right next to your family home, it's kind of interesting how that works, how it plants those seeds. You know, you're being modeled how to care for the land, how to be in tune with the land, how you reap what you sow by your father. And then you're being modeled by the firefighters there. This idea of service, of selfless service to community, to others, taking action, being on the front lines, all that kind of stuff. And so it just kind of creates this perfect storm, right? And so from the fire department, you were involved with firefighting next, is that right?
Yeah, so I this is so cool because I could just hop on the four-wheeler and I would ride down to the firehouse and just be there as the first guy there. So, you know, being able to be a part of that was huge. And I really wanted more. I was hungry for doing more firefighting. And I ended up joining CDF at the time, California Department of Forestry, now Cal Fire. So I joined that organization in 2004, and 2005 worked as a seasonal for 2 years, which was awesome. So I get to do, you know, be a real firefighter, go out and go on these big wildland fires, and then that would also help pay for school at Sacramento State. So all that worked out really well. And that's actually kind of what eventually brought me to the Army, because I remember being down, I was on a fire in Hemet, down in Southern California. And it was a fire that was kind of, it was down a ridge and we had to kind of hike down to it. You know, obviously anytime you're hiking down into a fire, this kind of a watch-out situation because obvious reasons, fire burns up.
Right.
So we ended up calling for a helicopter and just said, hey, we need some bucket drops on this spot fire. And I remember hiking down, watching the helicopter come in, make, 5 or 6 drops, puts the fire out. And it was a California Army National Guard Blackhawk.
Okay.
And I remember the pilots had their doors off and they're flying it like you're riding in a Jeep. And on the last drop, I remember one of the pilots looking down at me and giving me a shaka as he then flew off into the sunset. And I continued to, hit the ground and mop up with my shovel. And I said, what the heck am I doing this for, man? I'm going to go do that. So
like
a month later, I signed up for the National Guard. So.
You know, it's so cool. I mean, here we're talking about these little seeds that are planted.
When
you look at it this way, it sort of seems like so obvious, right? It's almost like someone's like inviting you to participate in your best life, you know?
Yes.
And you either make the choice or you don't, right? You could have chose to just kind of like, hey, and then kept doing what you're doing. But that inspired you and you followed that inspiration. Like, wow, that's cool. Like, And there are very few things that are cooler than like helicopter pilots. I mean,
well, you clearly don't know too many of us because we seem cool until you get to know a few.
Yeah, right, right. Well, that's how it is in any, right, exactly. But I will tell you, I mean, I think there just is something badass about it. I mean, I remember watching those old like Vietnam era movies with the air cavalry and all this stuff. And I just thought it was the coolest thing. That and fire pilots are pretty cool too.
So cool. So, I mean, it really is. It's so cool. There's a quote by, I think, Igor Sikorsky that says, if you need help on the ground, an airplane can come drop you flowers, but a helicopter can come save your life.
Right. So, you know, yeah, helicopters are fascinating. So you see this guy, you're on this fire, you get inspired to join the Army. You had already finished your degree or you're working on your degree at Sac State?
Working then, yep.
Okay.
Graduated in 06, so yep.
And you join ROTC, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so for those who don't know what that is, can you just explain real quick?
Sure, yeah. So there's basically three ways you can get commission into any of the services, and the Army is no different. There is, you know, you can go to West Point, which is the Service Academy, which is, mm-hmm. you know, 4 years of your life where you're kind of, you know, love my West Point friends, but there's not much college experience. Very, very disciplined, very difficult. And anyway, so you can do that, or you can join the Reserve Officer Training Corps, ROTC, which is also a lot of work, still a lot of discipline, but you're at a normal civilian school. And then mm-hmm. you do, you know, your drills and your PT and all that stuff throughout the week. And it still takes probably 10 or 15 hours a week. To do all these requirements.
Right.
And anyway, you go through, you get evaluated, you go to a summertime kind of boot training or boot camp. And then in your last year of college, your fourth year, you get your commission, and you get your college degree, and then you have a job right out of college. So that's the second way. The third way would be an officer candidate school. You already have a degree and you go in and you actually go to OCS, and get your commission that way. So, but I think, you know, ROTC is such a great option for people, especially if you're not sure that you like want to do it. Like, well, let me try it out. And if you don't right. like the Army, you can always bail. Unlike if you already signed up and you're going to West Point or OCS. So,
oh yeah,
it's a great way to check it out.
Yeah, it actually is that middle road. You know,
totally.
You can try it out. I mean, worst case scenario, it's an interesting experience, but you might find that you got something there. You know, a lot of guys by the end of their college career figure out that. They started wanting to be an engineer, but now they're interested in something else, you know,
totally.
But they have this engineering degree. It's like, okay. So that's really interesting. So it's funny. You're talking about all of this, like, you know, my dad was a forest firefighter. I think he worked for the U.S. Forest Service though. And I remember hearing stories about that. And he was also a firefighter paramedic in Petaluma, which I was born there. And so I remember, you know, my dad at the fire department feeling so like these guys were larger than life. These guys were like heroes, you know? And so it's cool to hear you talk about that. And it's really cool to see all those little tiny seeds that were planted and how you kind of followed that passion, which is a great, I mean, it's a cool metaphor too, because you're talking about planting and reaping what you sow and being in tune with your environment and how that cultivates something that's really interesting. And I can see that that's like, exactly what's happening with you. So, and it's, you know, I don't think it's an accident, you know, it's a product of that environment that you were able to grow up in. So that's really cool. So you get inspired, you join the ROTC, you get through, you get your commission. And then what's the next step there for you?
Yeah. So then after that, you know, but a week after commissioning and graduation, I was on the road, headed to Fort Sill, Oklahoma, did my basic officer leadership course there, and then went to San Antonio for another leadership course in kind of for med service. That's what the branch that I was commissioned into is the Medical Service Corps. And then after that, went to flight school at Fort Rucker and did, you know, a year and a half of flight school. So it was about 2 years of training before you're out in the real world as a brand new lieutenant, right? And then
right.
you still don't know anything. So
and so now you're a pilot. Are you pilot on Black Hawk or are you trained on different? Yeah, Black
Hawk. Just Hawks, yeah, just UH-60s, but I'm an instructor pilot in UH-60 Lima and Mike Models. The Mike Models, the newest one with all the glass cockpit, all the cool stuff.
Right, right.
And yeah, I love it. It's a great airframe. The thing is a tank, man. I mean, I've seen it come back, crashed into the ground, shot up with bullet holes, leaking fluid, and the thing is just a tank, keeps on going. And it
yeah.
has to be, because, I mean, you know, the Army, we've got guys out there as a pilot in command with 300-400 hours, you know, I mean, you got very junior people getting put in positions of really high responsibility, very young, and
yeah,
it can't be a delicate helicopter that you're flying. It's going to get beat up.
Yeah, I love the Blackhawks. You know, I've actually been in Blackhawks and I got to train in them and I got to actually use them in combat, which was super cool. And it was funny because I was supposed to be a tanker, but when I deployed, we ended up kind of being more like just dudes that did everything. Mm-hmm. And so we were doing all kinds of stuff, but I remember getting into those Blackhawks was such a cool experience working with those pilots. I remember, but the first time I got in one though, and I was looking around, I kind of like, it was like knocking on the side and I was looking at it and I was like, this is it. Like, this thing is,
it seems like,
are you sure this is like bolted together, right? Or it just, in your mind as a child, you think it's like, you know, you're watching G.I. Joe and you see, you think it's like some, you know, like the Titanic or something. It's so like, and you get in there and you're like, oh my God, like you're really just, you're cruising on this thing. And it's, you know, it was open air and you could just fall right out.
I mean, like, you talk about being in tune with your surroundings and like all of this, you know, well, there's no one more in tune with a contraption than a helicopter pilot, because you're always waiting for it to like fall apart. You know, it's like a thousand pieces just spinning in loose formation with light coat of oil on them.
It's incredible how it works. Yeah. I remember thinking like, wow, this is dangerous.
it's crazy, you know, but for some reason it
works.
Despite physics, the Blackhawk continues to just do a shine, man.
So the Blackhawk helicopter is associated with medevacs. Mm-hmm. And you are in the medical corps. So you're not a medic. So you're not like a flight medic, right? But you're a pilot. And is it that you're specializing or your job is essentially to pilot these sort of medevac?
Yeah. So what the Army has done is, and it's the only service that does dedicated with in-route medical care assets to move injured folks off the battlefield, right? And to complement that, we have our own basically corps of officers, the aeromedical evacuation officer, that that's their focus. And the Army does put a lot of focus on it because of the priority and how important it is. You know, when you have folks out there fighting a war, you want to make sure that they know that their government that's put them in that position is going to do everything possible to get them off the battlefield as quickly and safely as they can and get them patched up. It's a huge force multiplier. So in that, you know, like I said, we have our own core and of a lot of dedicated professionals that really care about the supporting the soldier or trooper on the ground.
Oh yeah. And, you know, just so people who are not in the military, haven't been in the military, you know, I can tell you as somebody who's a combat veteran, you know, we have so much respect for medics, for the medevac, the pilots, the crewmen. They really like Chris was saying, they really do care and they put their life on the line, like without even asking a question. We know, and it's just even knowing in the back of our mind that those guys are there and that if there's a situation where we're in trouble, someone's injured, ourselves, but even worse, one of our battle buddies is injured, that they're going to figure out a way to get the bird landed and they're going to get them the best care that they can, get them to the hospital as quick as they can. Just knowing that that's there was such a force multiplier, because the mind game in war, the psychological game, is huge.
Yes.
And so I personally have experienced just like appreciating and seeing it in action, having some of my buddies medevaced, you know, and saving their lives is just something that I'll never forget. So, you know, it's in the military, these people are very highly respected. So it's really cool to hear. I know that that's what you did. And that really resonates with me. And I think that's such a cool, powerful part of your story. And it just shows how you have been modeled this idea of service, of getting out there. You know, you're in the fires, you're putting yourself on the front line, you're trying to help people. And I think it speaks a lot to your character and to how you were raised. And I think it's really cool to just acknowledge that, because it's great work that you guys are doing out there. So now you're all trained up, you're good to go. You get into a line unit now, right? You're assigned to unit. And then what's going on between then and your two deployments? You have a deployment to Iraq, deployment to Afghanistan. Let's talk about how we get into the deployment component.
Yeah, so I was up in Alaska is where I was stationed, Fairbanks, Alaska, at Fort Wainwright. Beautiful area. I loved it. Ultimate freedom in Alaska, by the way. Just everything is right in that state. And it's fantastic. So we deployed out of Alaska. I was there for 4.5 years. I only spent 2 years properly in Alaska. The rest of it was training and being deployed. But we deployed first to Iraq. And I think we were kind of in this, in similar areas. I was in Diwaniya, Talil and Diwaniya, which is kind of southern Afghanistan, southern Iraq. And then we would travel every day, fly up to Baghdad International Airport, the Green Zone, Balad, you know, Sadr City. And these are all places that you were familiar with, right?
Right. Yeah. I was there. I was in Bob Falcon. So Falcon is, it's in Baghdad. It's right on MSR Tampa, which runs all the way north, south of the city. When you're in the city, it's called Route Irish, or was called Route Irish when I was there. And so that piece, our kind of area of operation, went all the way up to the sort of intersection, where the big road that runs east-west from the airport to the Green Zone is. And there's that big spaghetti junction, which is the big roundabout there, was kind of the marker for that. So yeah, right in that area. And, you know, we flew into Bayat, Baghdad Airport, and that was in the C-130, and I had no idea they were going to do that tactical landing, which
they love doing that. Even though there's no threat, they love doing just to mess everyone up in the back.
Dude, I hate flying anyways, and it was you know, there's another story too about like nearly being in a not an airplane, but actually in a, it wasn't a Black Hawk, it was a Chinook, I think, and it was when I was leaving Fob Falcon to fly to Bayat in a helicopter to leave and go home after my year deployment. And we're taking off and we're moving, and they shoot off flares. And I didn't know that was going to happen. And I thought we got hit with an RPG. And I was just like, oh my God, like,
this is it. I'm almost
going down.
Made it.
Like I almost made it, you know? And anyways, that was going down, but yeah. Okay. So yeah, that's interesting. And you were there, what time frame is this?
So I was there in 08, 09, okay. Kind of after the surge. I mean, and from what I hear from the years you were there, at 04, 05, I mean, just a wild time. And then the respect I've got for you guys, and that's what I was, man, the guys on the ground, like every day doing really, really tough stuff. And, you know, I'm sitting there in my chew watching, you know, movies, eating ice cream until we get a call.
Yeah.
And I mean, every day these guys are out there. So the biggest, the most respect I have is for those dudes on the ground, dudes and dudettes.
Yeah, you know, everybody tries, everybody feels that way though, right? So yeah. Like you guys are feeling that way. But you know, we're feeling that way, right? Everybody yeah. has this, I don't know what's the correct word for that? I don't know if it's,
just mutual respect, shared
yeah,
understanding.
Everyone's,
you know,
feeling like
yeah.
they're almost like they're not, you know, oh man, I'm not. It's like there's always somebody else who's the hero or who's the real badass, you
sure.
know, or whatever. But it's a real team effort. I mean, there's not yeah. a single aspect of the military, even the non-combat jobs, that, you know, you couldn't do what you do if it wasn't for everybody putting it together.
Yeah. But that's, I think, is like a kind of a philosophy that I miss. You don't get that a lot in the world we're in now. It's a little different. You get camaraderie, but it's not ever quite the same. And that's something that I think for a lot of vets, it's kind of hard to kind of deal with. It's like, oh, I had this great friend group and this instant camaraderie with anyone that was in, and you get out and it's a lot different, right?
Yeah. And I think you're right. And, you know, I think for me, from what I've experienced, and I don't know if you've experienced this too, but it's just that we don't live in America. We don't live in an environment where it's like a life or death situation. Most people, there are some places in America where people do live in those situations, but that's 1% of 1% maybe. So for most people growing up in America, they're just, the consequences of their decisions are not really life or death. And so that idea of trust, you don't really know how much you can trust somebody, but in the military, especially in a combat situation, everybody's all in. And you have that trust, you know, those pilots are going to come for you, and you know that they're going to act like their brother literally is there bleeding out and they have to get to him, and they're going to make it happen. And they're trusting that you're on the ground doing the very best that you can to win this war so that they can get home, you know, and everybody trusts each other. Absolutely. And you put that trust through trial or trial by fire, I mean, literally. And so in a situation where you don't have to have that trial by fire, you don't really know. And so there's all this kind of like, everybody's kind of very guarded. Everyone is a little bit more selfish in that way because they don't want to extend themselves and they can take an advantage of or whatever. But I know that's been my experience. But I want to talk about that first Iraq deployment because, sure. You know, it was a few years after I was there, but it was still a real dangerous time. Can you kind of like give us a few stories about like what are a couple of your like most memorable stories, combat stories, just interesting cool memories that are unique to that deployment in Iraq?
For sure. Yeah, Iraq was definitely, it was post-surge, so it had calmed down a little bit since 2007. That was the real busy time. Mm-hmm. Between your time and 2007. But for me, Iraq was a great learning experience. My commander at the time, Buddy Mader, was just a fantastic, fantastic officer. He pushed all the lieutenants out and let us be site leads, basically platoon leaders in these forward team sites. So I was the platoon leader out at Diwaniya, which was south of Baghdad. And it was the best lesson I could have ever gotten on personnel management, risk mitigation, and medevac as a whole, because I had 20 people that I was in charge of. And, you know, everyone didn't always get along. We had a lot of little issues, and that was up to me to kind of come in, tie everyone together and motivate people to accomplish the mission. And I learned a ton. I had some really good pilots, some really good crew members, and good ops folks as well. And we made it happen. So I think for me, Iraq was a learning experience. It wasn't overly kinetic. I mean, you know, there was occasionally some surface air fire. There was occasionally some IEDs. We got IDF'd a lot of mortar fire, rocket fire, onto our CHU. A couple hit the airfield, a couple hit right by our living area. So, you know, that was always challenging. But I think what Iraq did for me was it prepped me for Afghanistan. Afghanistan was the most trying time I think I've ever had in my life. It was much more difficult than Iraq ever was. And partially because we were in the middle of a surge there. It was in the south, you know, regional command south, right, kind of in Kandahar. So that to me was kind of what we had trained for. So let's talk about that.
You're second deployment now.
Sure.
You had your experience in Iraq. You come into Afghanistan. I've never been to Afghanistan, but from what I've heard, it's just a totally different animal over there. So
totally different. Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about the deployment and then maybe just some highlights or some things that you really took away from that?
Absolutely. So, you know, Afghanistan started a whole lot different than Iraq. Iraq was that initial kind of decentralized, huge push in that you were part of to help, you know, kind of clean up things as we went north. The Afghanistan started very slow. I guess after the initial push after 9/11 kind of slowed down, and it was very centralized command. And it had stayed centralized up until, you know, 2010, 2011, when it really started to like become a problem. And there was a lot more kinetic actions going on. We flooded that country with a lot of people, a lot of more medevac assets. And we were part of that flood that was like, hey, you guys just got back, you know, 12 months ago from Iraq, you're on the plane again going back to Afghanistan, because we just needed more medevac. And also the Secretary of Defense and Vice Chief of Staff of the Army at that point had made the 15-minute launch rule and the one-hour golden hour rule, which meant you had to, by doctrine, get anyone that was injured to surgical capability within 1 hour. And to support that, you had to launch an aircraft within 15 minutes. So we need a lot more people.
So for people that don't really understand, I mean, I'm thinking about that, and it sounds like, oh, an hour is a long time. But like, can you talk to me about, like, you're in Afghanistan, someone is, I don't know, whatever, 15 miles outside your base on patrol, they get hit by an IED, and you've got some casualties that are like urgent and they need to get to surgery quick to save their lives. What happens? You're sitting back at your base or your talk or wherever you're at. Can you walk us through that, all the steps that you have to go through in order to be able to get that person to a surgical environment?
Yeah, absolutely. And that was what we focused on, was as quickly as we can. But just to give you an idea of kind of the space and time involved in this. So we were based in Kandahar, but we had a second forward base out of Fob Basab or Fob Wilson, which was only a 10-minute flight away, but it was such a kinetic area. We had so many injuries every day that we stationed two helicopters 10 minutes away from our base just so we could be 10 minutes quicker. But anyway, you know, what the kind of the process is here is, you know, there's always a platoon out working. Usually the first call would be at 7 or 8 in the morning, after they were out patrolling. You know, a lot of IEDs, a couple direct fire engagements a day, but someone would get injured, and then their platoon would make the call up through their chain of command, and then they would relay it over to the aviation brigade. The aviation brigade would then task it down to the units, and it seems like it might be this arc that needs to happen of communications, and it is, and that takes, you know, 5 or 10 minutes. But we would usurp that by monitoring all of the, you know, company and battalion traffic in our area. So you'd see a mission coming down. You'd know they were calling it up. So you would get the jump on it. You'd run out to the helicopter, get that pig ready to get in the air. And by the time you're at fly and ready to go, you've already gotten approval from your headquarters in an ideal world. And then
you
launch.
Is that SOP? Is that what you, or is that something you guys just did to try to get a jump on things?
It became SOP, but yeah, it was one of those things that was, hey, how can we speed this up? Cause we know these missions are happening, you know, these injuries are happening and we are getting a delay on it. How can we speed it up? So that's where we started, you know, and it wasn't just us that came up with it.
Worst case scenario, you get stood down for some reason.
Totally. Yeah. Who cares? You know, burn some fuel, be ready to go.
And 10 minutes is like, I mean, you can imagine if you're out gardening and you cut your finger off, you know, imagine going to the hospital versus sitting there for 10 minutes and then going to the hospital.
They call it the platinum 10 minutes for a reason. If you don't stop that uncontrolled hemorrhaging within 10 minutes, you die. Mm-hmm. Like, you bleed out.
So it's a big deal. That is, every minute counts. Okay. So then you're in, you get approval. And you're off.
You take off, and then you're en route to the what we call POI, point of injury. And in that specific spot that I'm talking about, it was very kinetic. It was called also the green zone for a different reason. That was part of the Zari Panjway. And with the Zari Panjway come together, there's a river, in the Panjway River, and that's called the Horn of Panjway. That's where the local farmers and the Taliban would grow a lot of their marijuana, a lot of their poppies for opium. So it was a very busy agricultural area that was trying, it was being vied for control by the Taliban. So there was a big fight going down there. It was a lot of, of places for people to hide.
Big money.
That's where they would get all their money from. They would, you know, they'd coerce these farmers into making, you know, planting poppies and for opium. And that's where they, you know, then work in the illicit opium trade.
Right.
And so anyway, they're trying this, to defend.
You're flying through this, you know, place where there's a lot of enemy who are motivated, right, to defend themselves, to take care of their area. And you're flying to go help people, but you're flying through a very dangerous area and putting yourself at risk just moving through that area.
Yep, absolutely. So, you know, our tactics and procedures would be, you know, stay high. We were relatively safe from any sort of a missile threat just due to systems on aircraft and the lack of those type of threats. But the small arms was a very high, small arms and RPGs was a very high threat. So we'd stay high and then descend in. We would talk to the ground unit. And this is where it gets busy, right? So you've got a whole bunch of different people you've got to talk to. You're, say, 10 kilometers out, you're calling the ground unit who's telling you what they've got on the ground, what type of injury, where they are, what their LZ looks like. You're also talking typically to an air weapons team, which is some Apaches or 58 Kiowa Ds that are flying around giving support to the ground unit and clearing you in. You're also talking to your higher headquarters, letting them know what's going on. You're talking to any other aircraft that are in the area on a common traffic frequency. So there's four radios going. And then I forgot there's a SATCOM radio, there's a fifth radio. And you have to keep people updated on that in the hospital and let them know what's going on. So between the crew, everybody is working. One person's flying with a few radio calls. The other person is managing the radios and the maps. The medic in the back is making calls, trying to figure out where we're going to take this person. Anyway, you get close to the LZ. You do some, you know, some fancy flying. You land there. You hopefully don't get shot too bad. You pick the guys up, and then there's no staying and playing. It is like, get them in the aircraft, and we are off, right?
Right.
And then you've also got your chase bird behind you that's covering you. You tell them which way you're taking off, you blast out of there, and you're hopefully about 10 minutes away from Kandahar for the hospital. You smoke in there, right? You drop your patient off, and then you clean, you go back to your base, you wash the aircraft out because it's typically full of blood, and you pull some of the armor panels out and clean everything up, and then you're ready for the next one. And it is a quick we're talking maybe 45 minute adventure, and then you're back to the next one.
From takeoff to placing the patient down at their final location, or to getting back?
From even getting back. So yeah, wow. We're talking like we would have folks at the hospital between 25 and 45 minutes.
Wow. So what's it like landing in a potentially, you know, hostile environment? I mean, what's right. It like trying to, you don't know exactly where, I mean, you know where you're going to, but you haven't landed there specifically. So, I mean, it could be anything. It could be terrain features that are difficult. There could be enemy fire. I mean, what's that like? What's that feel like getting down in there?
It's wild. It is the, the most adrenaline inducing event I've ever done and will ever do in my life. The most exciting flying, most terrifying flying. And one of the really most poignant things I remember is I would be flying in. We would, the unit would pop smoke. You'd confirm the color. You'd set up your final approach. Again, like you said, you don't have any idea of what the terrain looks like. A lot of times it's really dusty and you're doing a dust landing. But often we would be landing into these fields, and often they're poppy fields. So you'd set up your approach, you'd land into a poppy field, and it's this beautiful juxtaposition of these poppies, just multicolored poppies that are flying all around as you land, a little bit of dust, and then it smells great, but then you have the other smells that take over. You have the cordite, the explosives, the blood, the sweat, mm-hmm. the dust, that everything just melts together in this wild, very distinct smell. And you've got that, the smoke kind of, burbling around as well. And you're loading the patients on, and it is the most surreal, wild thing of like awful and beautiful scene you've ever seen. It's just nuts. You know, it's just really a weird, you kind of look up, you're like, what are we doing? Like, this is wild.
Right.
And you slide the folks on, and, you know, depending on the urgency of that patient, you know, how fast you fly and how much collective you're pulling to get them to the hospital. But wow. Yeah, often very weird. And the other thing coming full circle here, which is weird, is especially in the southern part of Afghanistan, they grow a lot of grapes. So there's grape fields everywhere.
Oh, wow.
And I always remember landing into sometimes on top of a grape field and smelling that, like the smell of grape leaves. And be like, this is, again, just super surreal, right? So you land and you've got these grape leaves flying up everywhere. And it's too bad they only use them for raisins. They don't make wine, obviously.
Right.
But, you know, maybe some year they'll change.
Yeah, wow. Maybe there's a future there.
Yeah, exactly.
That's incredible. And as you're telling that story, you know, it resonates with me because I really feel that, you know, war is interesting in that I feel like war really highlights contrast, and everything becomes more meaningful. It's more, every moment is kind of, you start noticing these juxtapositions, the ironies, the metaphors. Everything becomes so meaningful in that way. Like you were talking about, that juxtaposition of landing down onto a poppy field and how it really was a beautiful moment. It was an exhilarating moment. And you were taking note of that. And then you have it mixed with this sort of other component that is also very extreme. And it's like that extreme, you know, I'm in a situation where I could be killed. I'm trying to rescue, save somebody's life. There's all of these things going on. I have to be precise. I can't make a mistake. So it's an intense situation. And then you're also in this beautiful environment too. And you're sort of, it highlights that like you're living life, you're alive, you know, like you have consciousness and this world is so dynamic and there are so many different experiences and it's really a work of art that you're living in. And you just sort of like, it, I think that those experiences really pop and they stick. I have a tattoo on my arm. You can't really see it that well, but you can see it's a silhouette of a soldier with night vision and the sunset in the background, because I always loved in Iraq, these beautiful sunsets. And as we were getting ready to go out on night patrols, which is where we would do raids and all of the action really took place at night, except for some IED stuff during the day. but that's where raids and anybody who was out after curfew was up to no good. And that's where we would get into gunfights and things like that. And so you're getting ready to go out on this patrol and you're trying to mentally prepare yourself for the raid, for doing all this kind of kinetic stuff. And kinetic just means action. And so you're kind of reflecting on that. But then I remember just really being at peace with this beautiful sunset. And I remember seeing my buddy standing there, night vision up, right? Because it's not quite dark yet, but we're getting ready to go. And they have this beautiful silhouette of the sunset and everything. And I just remember thinking like, whoa, what a juxtaposition of like preparing to put the night vision down and go to work at night, thinking about what that might mean. Is this my last night on earth? But then also this just natural beauty of the earth in this place is, and just like thinking, wow, like, what does that even mean? You know, I'm not sure what that means, but I know it's meaningful. So when you're telling that story, it's like, oh yeah, like, of course, this is something that isn't just unique to me and my experience. Like if there's something about it, and I don't know about you, but I feel like a lot of times combat veterans and warriors in general will become artists and will want to be involved with something that is more emotionally driven and more artistic. Because they're trying, or writers or poets, because they're trying to find this sort of balance, and they're trying to find a way to describe that really meaningful experience that they had in those kind of little moments that you're describing. I don't know how you feel about it, but I'm kind of interested in what you think about that. And then also how do you go from that to then coming back to the Napa Valley, back to Morosoli Vineyards, reflecting on your past and how it was kind of this beautiful childhood, this great experience, but now you've had this experience in Iraq and Afghanistan and you're back here. And what was that experience like for you?
Sure. Well, yeah, you go from these poignant, like you said, condensed moments of like absolute intense emotion and feeling. And then, and I had a good amount of years in the Army after Afghanistan to kind of, you know, realize that not every year was going to be as wild as that. And thank you, know, for good reason. And things did calm down a little bit in terms of action, if you will. But I stayed really busy just as a, you know, company commander. I commanded two companies after Afghanistan, one in Honduras and one in Hawaii. And what was great about that was I got to really focus on doing some other diverse stuff. So in Honduras, you know, a lot of humanitarian aid, disaster relief. I really put a lot of focus into helping in those aspects, helping with medevac, with local nationals. And then in Hawaii, focused on kind of the whole pivot to the Pacific, right? So going to all these different Southeast Asian countries and training with their local military, training with the Malaysian Army, training with the Indonesian Army, doing some presidential support or VPOTUS support missions. So really getting an awesome opportunity to do some very unique stuff. So that kept me busy. But what was hard, yeah, like you said, when you leave that lifestyle, which I did in 2018, come back to Rutherford, it's like, it's definitely a change, right? And you're like, holy smokes. I used to, you know, run 15 helicopters, 120 people in five different countries. And you know, now my dad's like, all right, go spray the weeds in the ditch.
Yeah.
and it's great. I needed it at that point. I needed to like just slow down a little bit. But then you're out there spraying weeds, you're like, huh, well, wonder what I would be doing if I wasn't, if I wasn't this ditch spraying weeds right now. And what's been great about the National Guard, it's allowed me to still do all of this stuff, and still be able to be at home and work on the vineyard and, you know, make wine and do all this cool stuff that I'm doing, which I would never be able to do if I was full-time Army. So there's this like really hard balance to find for me. I knew that at that point in 2018 in my life in the Army, I was going to do nothing that I really enjoyed anymore. It was the end of my company command. I was destined for staff jobs. I was going to fly an LMD. It's a large metal desk. And it was like, I had to come to grips with, hey man, you're not going to get to do the cool stuff anymore. Right. And thankfully that all worked out because my dad was like, hey, you going to come back and help me? And I was in a position to luckily get out at the right time, come home. And the deal I have now is the best deal you could possibly have. I get to do all of the great stuff, learn from my dad, learn this really detailed, system of farming and then still do, you know, fly and still fight fire and all that. And I think the biggest thing that I've learned, and it's been hard for me, is seeing your actions in the long term, right?
Right.
Because everything I'd ever done was always instant gratification, instant, like, we went and did a mission, we saved this guy, we went and trained with this army. It was instant. And it's very different in farming. There's no instant gratification. You've got to play the long game,
right?
And you don't see your results from, you don't see them immediately. Sometimes you don't see them for 5 years.
Right.
So to me, that was like a huge learning experience. Like, whoa, man, like, chill out. Just wait. And that's why my dad's like, just calm down. Wait, it'll be fine. I'm a pretty high energy guy as it is. So it was good for me to see that, hey, things take time and farming takes time and not everything is an immediate reaction to what you've done.
That's amazing. So this is like the perfect balance for you, right? Because you can still get some of that immediate action stuff and feel like you're in a leadership position in that way, but then also be connected to your family, to your roots. And then I guess it'd be a good time to pivot to where are you now with Marsali Vineyard, with your wine brand, and then where are you seeing yourself going with all of that? And even with your military career too.
Yeah. Well, again, luckily my dad is extremely patient with me and my mom, allowing me to go out and, you know, spend a third of my year doing, these other, army adventures or fire department adventures. But it's been a great experience in getting to know what it takes to kind of run the vineyard. And I think my goal with that is just to continue to, kind of pull all of that knowledge and collect some of that knowledge that my dad has over, 50, 60 years of working vineyards, to kind of understand what it takes. And that's been really interesting. And I'm always learning something new. There's always a challenge. And a lot of it's not just the farming part, but it's the maintenance part. There's always a tractor broken. There's always something that's broken that you got to fix. And I've learned kind of a little bit about how to do that, in the last few years. It's been really, really good. But then, it's good that I can, when farming slows down, when it's like winter time, I can go do some other army stuff and kind of have a little diversity.
Yeah, that's perfect. I'm excited to see where it takes off. I mean, like I said, I've always heard, really good things about Marsali Vineyard. I knew about the vineyard for a long time. Has a reputation for, growing amazing grapes. But it's going to be cool to see where you take that brand and how that unfolds.
The quick rundown on that. In 2018, my dad, when I got home, he said, well, we'd always talked about making wine, but never actually been serious about it. And he said, well, why don't you give it a shot? And I was really surprised. I was like, cool. Like, all right. We were sitting at the Pioneer Saloon in Ketchum, Idaho. And he's like, well, give it a shot. So we decided to take a few tons that year, about 2.5 tons, and start a wine brand. And that was, kind of went back and forth a little bit on names and finally decided, hey, just stick with Marsali. Why not? It's the best you got. There's a bunch of new brands. Stick with something that's, been around for a while. So we sell that as the name. We had been working with Joel Aiken for 20 or 30 years. He'd always purchased our fruit for their clients, or we'd worked with him when he was the winemaker at Beaulieu Vineyards, which he was for like 27 years. He did his thesis on the difference between French and American oak on Cabernet Sauvignon, right? So he is like dialed into everything.
Right.
Right. Especially Rutherford was. So we got Joel to help make the wine with us. Did it at Matera for the actual custom crush. And then had some really great folks like Jeff Hansen took pictures. He was our photographer. Cynthia Kirk did the label. And everything came together with this really special brand. And again, it's just Marsali Vineyard. And it's a very kind of classic label. The wine is made classically. It's not super over extracted. We use 60% new French oak, and everything is just a real kind of restrained classic Napa Cabernet. and it's outstanding. I love it.
Beautiful. Well, I haven't had any yet, so I'll have to try some of that. But I mean, I'm sure it's amazing. So you got everything
your name on it, brother.
All right, you got you got the pedigree, you got everything lined up. So just to kind of wrap things up, I appreciate you sharing your story. It's pretty incredible, and a lot of the stuff I didn't even really get to understand the full picture of, you know, your whole experience. It's a pretty amazing story, and I think it's something that just being from the Napa Valley here, or being living in the Napa Valley now for, I don't know, 15, 16 years, it's cool to see that there's people like that here and that their origin is really from the land, from here. They're really true Napa Valley born and bred. And it's cool to see that we have some similarities, some shared experiences too, which we should chat more about sometime. At the end of the podcast, I want to give the guests just a few minutes to, because I think the bigger picture, I'm always looking at the bigger picture. Like, why is this meaningful? And one of the bigger things is that that we're all human. And while we have different experiences and different stories, there are a lot of things we have in common as human beings. And so anytime that we can get somebody else, especially someone who's had a lot of experience, a lot of really interesting experience, to share something on a human level, like if you could share something with the world, a small message, just a thought, an idea, a concept, something you've learned over time that you felt is like really meant something to you, that might mean something to other people, might be valuable to them, might be useful to them, might just, sound good or whatever, then I'd like to invite you to go ahead and give us some of that wisdom now before we sign off. And no pressure, just
cool. Well, I would say, let me give you a quarter to call someone who actually knows, there's a little bit more wisdom than I do, but I appreciate it. I don't know. I think one thing I've learned, just in especially being between the Army and the wine industry, is not to take yourself too seriously. We see that all the time in both of these aspects, right? In both of these kind of professions. And I think it's always really refreshing when someone's just, they take the job seriously, they take the people seriously, but you can't take yourself too seriously. You've always got to realize that that you're small, you're a tiny part of this, and the world's big, and there's a lot more people and a lot of stuff going on that is bigger than you. So I think that's one of the things that I've taken away. I try not to take myself too seriously, and then also another really cool piece of advice. I can't take credit for this. This is from Francis Coppola, and he always says, you know what the meaning of life is, Chris? Do you know what the meaning of life is? I said, I don't know, Francis. What is it? He says, it's skating on thin ice and enjoying the parts where you glide. And that's pretty awesome. We're all skating on thin ice, so you might as well enjoy what you're doing.
That is fantastic. And it's coming from Francis Ford Coppola.
Exactly.
Definitely knows what he's talking about, and he's had a lot of experience. That makes so much sense, right? And it's really making that choice to enjoy that sort of fragile part of life, because life really is fragile. You've seen that in your life. And, lastly, I'll just say, man, I think it's a really cool story, but it's really awesome to see people who have a service mindset and who are selfless and really put their money where their mouth is, put their life on the line. And it's just the good stuff. It's the good stuff. It's a fantastic example for our younger generation, and inspires me. And so, and I think your advice about not taking yourself too seriously, it's actually simple, but very important advice and stuff, something that I've learned the hard way. And I'm still learning, I'm still learning to let go of a lot of the I, me type of thing, and to really like open up to the bigger picture, and feel how that is actually a fuller experience. And it's not a limiting experience. You're not losing anything by doing that. You're gaining. So I think that's actually really sage advice. So appreciate it. All right. So how can we get a hold of you if people are interested in finding out about your winery, vineyard, or just you yourself? What are the best ways to get a hold of you?
For sure. Well, exciting news. Our website launches this week. So GomorrahSolivineyard.com. You can check it out. And we'll release our 2018 in about 2 weeks. So it should be out there on the market. You should see it. And yeah, I hope people check it out. And then, of course, Instagram at Morisoli Vineyard, and my personal is at C Morisoli. So very generic and boring, but easy to find.
At See Morisoli.
Oh, you got it.
Okay, cool. All right, man. Well, thank you so much. I really appreciate your time. And thanks for being on the first episode of Decanted.
Hey, I'm honored, man. You're going to look back and like the first episode, man, we've gone nowhere but up from there.
Yeah, no, not at all. No, we'll have a reunion episode someday and it'll be good. But and we'll get together in between it. Now and then. Maybe I'll jump on your podcast too.
Looking forward to it, buddy.
All right, thanks, we'll Dave. See you.
Bye. All right, bye.